rotting bones and chest, Rupert?
Yes.
Well, what of it?
Do you remember when you were an infant, Brandon?
Mm-mm.
And I used to tell me stories around the fire.
Yes. Yes, rather. I remember.
Do you remember your chest complex, Brandon?
My chest complex?
Yes. Whatever the story was, piratical, detective, meta-adventure, ghost, it always contained a marvelous denouement with a bloody chest containing corpses. You had the perfect mania for it. Don't you remember?
Yes. I've forgotten that.
Why? Should you have remembered it?
Yes. Yes, it's quite true. I remember now. What about it?
Oh, nothing. Just queer, that's all.
How queer, exactly?
Oh, just queer. Us all talking tonight about rotting bones and chests. It just came back to me, that's all.
Oh! Oh, I see what you mean. Yes. Are you going to have some of this, Rupert?
What's that? Whiskey? Yes, please.
All right. But don't get up. I'll get it. Say when.
When? No, a little more. When? Oh, when?
Happy days.
So how's the old man getting on with his books?
Going to take the entire library with them as far as I can see. I'm simply saying goodbye to it.
I didn't know you were a book collector.
I've only been one for about a year.
What exactly is your line?
Well, I've theories about some of the Victorians. Everything comes round, you know, in time.
For example?
For example? Well, Matthew Arnold, Carlyle, and people of that sort.
Matthew Arnold, perhaps.
And what's wrong with Carlyle?
My dear Brandon, an unspeakable person. Pull yourself together.
Oh, no. I don't agree with you. He's got guts, anyway.
Guts?
And a kind of angry righteousness which you don't get nowadays.
Thank God.
Well, I must go in and function. Aren't you coming?
Yes. Ah, I like this one. I say, what's the time? I want to be home very early tonight.
Plenty of time, Rupert. Come along. Now I've left the cigarettes. Do go in, Rupert, and I'll be in a moment.
Oh, What in God's name do you mean?
Oh, God!
What's the matter, man? Tell me what's the matter!
I thought it was him! I thought it was him! I thought it was Ronald!
God's sakes, drink that! And be quick, man!
Why were you sitting there? Why were you trying to frighten me?
I wasn't trying to frighten you. I was wondering what you were up to. I wasn't even sure if it was you. Why did you want to sneak in like that? You got what you deserve. Hang you! You've upset me.
I wanted to see that everything was all right. I'm sorry. My nerves going. I'm all right. I'll be all right. I'll be all right. Give me some more of that.
Get up! Get up! I'm going into the other room. Come in when you can. Don't get drunk on that.
No. Down the wrong way. What are you back here for?
They want those Beethoven records. You know, the old ones. I couldn't find them in there. You had them last, didn't you? Are they in here or upstairs?
Oh, yes. They're upstairs in my room.
Where are they? I'll go and get them.
They'll be a hell of a nuisance to get at. They're at the bottom of my drum.
What? The green one?
Yes. They're right at the bottom. And it's locked. Must they have their Beethoven records?
Alright. You go and tell them. You're alright, aren't you?
Yes. Quite.
One moment, Rano.
Yes.
Shut the door.
Yes.
You've got that little ticket, haven't you? You'd better give it to me and we'll destroy it right away now.
What ticket?
Ronald's ticket.
What Ronald's ticket?
Oh, don't dither, Grano. Ronald's ticket. Ronald's Coliseum ticket.
Ronald's Coliseum ticket?
Shh! Not so loud, you fool! Yes.
I haven't got the Coliseum ticket.
Don't be a fool, Grano. I gave it to you.
You didn't give it to me.
Grano!
Wait!
Grano!
You didn't!
Hip pocket!
You didn't!
Look again! Look again!
You didn't give it to me. I never had it.
I gave it into your hand.
You didn't! I never had it!
I gave it into your hand!
See if you got it.
I haven't got it, I tell you. Where is it?
Where is it?
Shh! I put it in my waistcoat pocket.
You put it in your waistcoat pocket. Well, where is it now?
My dear Brandon, what have you lost?
My temper, Rupert. Sorry about that, Grano.
That's all right. Oh, I hope I'm not interfering.
Oh, no. Not at all, Rupert. You didn't know that Grano and I behaved like that, did you? But we often have little outbursts like that, and always about trifles, eh, Grano?
Yes.
On this occasion, it was a question of a case of Beethoven gramophone records which poor old Grano couldn't produce. I was chiding him for his remissness. The party will have to do without its Beethoven tonight, I'm afraid.
Well, it's an ill wind that blows nobody any good. What a queer thing to quarrel about.
Yes. But we do often quarrel about queer things nowadays, don't we, Grano?
We do.
Can I have another drink?
Grano?
Yes? Whiskey?
Yes, please. Can I have some soda?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Ah, thank you ever so much. As a matter of fact, I'm in here on an errand.
An errand?
Yes, I want some rope.
Rope?
Yes, why so excited? Rope. The young people in the other room, having exhausted the lyric possibilities of the gramophone, are now projecting their entire youthful elan and ingenuity into the composition of a parcel, and they want something to do it up with.
A parcel?
Yes, the old man's books. You better see what goes into it, though. I'm sure he's lifting all your best. Hello, here we are. I thought it was coming.
Damnation. Yes, it's coming down all right.
Surely you two are...
My dear Brandon, surely we're not going in this?
Oh, yes, we are. It'll clear up soon. Besides, there's nowhere to sleep here. The beds are all dismantled.
Oh, that needn't worry you. You can put up with me if you care.
No, thank you, old boy. I'm sure we'll try and make it.
Very well, have it your own way.
Hello, did you hear that?
We heard it all right. We're scared of our wits.
I know, and it's simply coming down the chute. Surely you're not going to Oxford tonight?
Certainly we are.
But my dear, you can't. You'll simply be swamped out, my dear. A flooded, my dear.
I hear you want some string, Leila.
Time when I really enjoy the wireless.
That's the storm, I expect.
Here you are.
Da.
And here.
dear. You are.
Well, now we want the string. Where's the string?
Oh, the string. It's in the other room. I'll get it.
Oh, no, no, no. I'll get it. Where is it?
It's in that sort of big vase thing. You know.
Do you know the sort of big vase thing?
Oh, yes, I know. I'll get it.
Isn't he sweet?
Yes. He is rather a lamb.
Yes, a decided duck.
Here we are.
Oh, and Sir Johnstone wanted to know if he could browse on that sort of top shelf thing. I really didn't quite follow.
Oh, yes. What he was. Yes, yes, I know what he means. I say, Grano, do go in and explain to him. The poor old man is getting into hopeless muddles.
I should say completely.
What? Ronald Blotto? Yes, he is a bit. It's this whiskey.
Hello, listen. It's coming back again.
Oh, my hat!
I do believe you're afraid of storms, Leela.
My dear, I am. I simply rush round in circles. It's hereditary, you know. You should see my mother.
What does she rush around in?
My dear, she does it. She simply hides herself in cupboards.
Really?
All entangled in the linen, my dear. If it comes on again, you'll probably all see me take a violent plunge into this chest.
I should love to see that.
Head foremost, my dear. By the way, can you get into this chest, or is it locked?
Can you get into this chest, Brandon? Or is it locked?
What? Oh, the chest! Yes, you can get into it if you want to.
Oh, well, then I'm safe.
But isn't there a lock on that, though?
Yes, there is.
My dear, you've forgotten. He's got his murdered man in here.
Oh, we've forgotten that, hadn't we?
Well, you may have. I haven't. I say, can I have another spot?
Oh, yes, of course, Leela. I'm sorry. And you too, Kenneth?
Oh, well, I think I would, really.
Yes, that's what he's been committing. Murder. Finger, please. No, here. That's right. And we've caught him, red-handed.
Ah, Leela, you do not know how near the mark you are.
Oh, don't I? I know exactly what's inside this chest.
What?
There's an old, old man. You picked him up selling papers in the street, and you did him to death for the gold fillings in his teeth. For lust for gold, my dear.
Oh, I see you have been following me.
No, it is locked, isn't it? And why a padlock? What have you got in it?
But you already know, Leela. You've already explained to us what is in it.
No, I honestly think you ought to let us have a look. Have you got the key?
Yes, I've got the key. It's in my waistcoat pocket.
Well, hand it over and let's have a look inside.
Oh, I'm hanged if I do.
But why not, my dear? If you're really innocent, you can prove it, dear.
But how often have I to tell you, Leela, that I'm not innocent? My hands are red with a crime committed less than 3 hours ago.
Oh, well, if you won't. Damn. You won't. All the same.
same. If I had strong men about me, they'd force it from you.
I'll be your strong man.
Will you? All right, go and be strong.
How do I do that?
Oh, that's up to you.
All right, then. Now then, Mr. Brandon, hand it over, or it will be the worse for you.
Said he, eyeing the other fearlessly.
Come and get it, Kenneth.
Which pocket is it in?
Top. Right.
Mine are yours.
Mine.
Go on, seize it.
I'll give him 10 seconds then, shall I?
That's right.
Right you are. 10 seconds.
1, 2, 3.
Won't you surrender?
No.
4, 5, 6, 7. Hooray! My dears, what will men not do for me? Slaughtering each other, of course.
Mr. Raglan, we cannot on every occasion be strong, but it is always possible to be silent. What is he doing to you?
I thought he'd bust my arm. I say, Brandon, you don't know your own strength. You gave me an awful foul tug.
Kenneth, I am profoundly sorry. Really.
No, that's all right. It's what you used to do to me at school, anyway. So I guess I'm not your strong man after all.
Never mind. You come back to Mother Hart. I think he's a beast.
No, Leila. Only a desperate criminal is all. You must forgive me.
All right, I'll forgive you. There was room in our heart even for the lowest of God's creatures. A criminal and an outcast.
How fearfully interested in crime we all seem tonight. Why poor Brandon can't be allowed to commit his own murders in quiet, I don't know.
Ah, but I'm a sleuth. I'm professionally interested, you see?
Pearl White.
That's right, Pearl White. Besides, it's all a question of bringing assassins to justice.
Oh? How would you do that?
Why, by having them arrested, of course.
Oh, well then, do it, though. I have heard of assassins being brought to the Old Bailey, but I have seldom heard of them being brought to justice. I hope you're not confusing the two.
Well, what's wrong with the Old Bailey, anyway?
My dear Leila, its blemish is single but ineradicable. It is human. Justice is not.
Hear, hear.
Oh, I say. Are you one of those people that doesn't approve of capital punishment?
I think possibly I approve of murder too much to approve of capital punishment.
Approve of murder?
My dear Leila, there are so many people I would so willingly murder, particularly the members of my own family. And including the aunt so felicitously described by Mr. Raglan as living in Bayswater, that it would be positively disingenuous to say that I don't approve of murder. Furthermore, I have already committed murder myself.
How do you get that?
It is all simply a question of scale. You, my friends, have paradoxically a horror of murder on a small scale, a veneration for it. On a large scale. That is the difference between what we call murder and war. One gentleman murders another in a back alleyway in London. For let us say, since you have suggested it, the gold fillings in his teeth. And all society shrieks out for revenge upon the miscreant. They call that murder. But when the entire youth and manhood of a whole nation rises up to slaughter the entire youth and manhood of another, not even for the gold fillings in each other's teeth, and society condones and applauds the outrage and calls it war. How then can I say that I disapprove of murder, seeing that in the last great war, I acted on these assumptions myself? A lamentable thing, certainly, and responsible for the fact that tonight, instead of being able to fool around the gramophone with you two, a thing I should very much like to have done, I have to hobble about like an old man on one leg. But the point is that I prove that I don't disapprove of murder, haven't I?
No, you've done nothing of the sort. You'd be the first to be horrified by murder if it happened under your own nose.
I wonder.
Besides, you must have some moral standards.
Must I? I don't recall any.
Don't be absurd. You wouldn't hurt a fly.
Wouldn't I? I have hurt thousands in my time. Anyways, perhaps I...
No, do go on.
No, do go on, please.
No, do go on. Well,
I was going to...
No, do go on.
I'm very sorry. Shall we toss up?
Well, all I was going to say...
Yes?
All I was going to say is that I call that a jolly good parcel.
Excellent.
Well... Now, what were you going to say?
I've really no idea. What are your own moral standards then, Leila?
Mine?
Oh, Leila believes in the Ten Commandments, doesn't she?
Oh, no, surely not.
Why? What's wrong with the Ten Commandments?
Nothing whatever.
Indeed.
I have no doubt that they were of the profoundest significance, the nomadic needs of the tribe to whom they were delivered. Their inadequacy and irrelevance for today, though, must be sufficient to condemn them. I have often attempted to discover whether it is within the range of any of us to observe each of them. Honor my father and mother. Of course I do. How could I do otherwise? Indeed, on the occasion of my birthday, I have never failed to send them a telegram of congratulation. Though whether this will make my days any longer in the land which has been given us must remain in doubt. But look at the others. Keep holy the Sabbath day. I don't. Take not the name of the Lord in vain. I do. Thou shalt not murder, but I have done murder as I have explained.
And the seventh, Rupert.
Committed since infancy. Thou shalt not steal, but property itself, as Proudhon has explained to us, is theft. And I am a man of property. Moreover, these are your matches. Indeed, the only clause that I am sincerely capable of adhering to is a little stricture concerning my neighbor's ox and my neighbor's ass. Fewer and far between are my neighbor's own oxes, and fewer and farther between are my neighbor's own asses. I could face either type in an emergency with a pure heart, but then it would be different if I lived in a rural district.
Well, anyway, I... still say you've never committed murder. Your conscience wouldn't let you.
Ah, but have I a conscience?
He's quite right. And for one who hasn't a conscience, I can see murder being an entirely engrossing adventure.
You mean a motiveless murder?
Yes.
Yes. That does happen sometimes, doesn't it? You do get people who... murder, purely for the sort of fun of the thing, don't you?
What a peculiar idea of fun.
No, but I've heard of cases like that.
Indeed you have, and I, for one, can certainly enter into the excitement of it. The trouble with that sort of thing is that you're bound to be found out.
Why should you be found out?
Because, dear Brandon, that sort of murder will not be a motiveless murder at all.
would have a quite clear motive. Vanity. It would be a murder of vanity. And because of that, the criminal would be quite unable to keep from talking about it or showing it off in some fantastic way or another. The trouble with that sort of murderer is that he can't keep quiet about it. He won't hide it up. He wants to boast about it. To say something, do something. It may be something just slightly hautoir, which gives him away. They have always done it, and they always will.
But then, suppose you're a murderer. You're really ideal, brilliantly clever, and competent murderer. A genius at it, I mean. Suppose he was alive to the fact that vanity was the Achilles heel to the thing, and went specially out of his way to make sure he wasn't caught like that. I'm talking of a genius at it.
Oh, yes, but then you'd be quite unable from talking about the very fact he was so brilliantly clever, as you put it. He'd give himself away just the same.
Yes, but he might be so clever.
Might, but wouldn't. Don't you think so?
Ah, here we are. It's coming back again.
Lord, yes! I'm getting sick of this storm.
Yes, so am I. I say, you know, it's really about time I ought to be going.
Yes, same here, really.
What's a curious coincidence. Now you'll both be able to go together.
I say, isn't it absolutely awful?
Isn't it terrible? You two aren't really still going up tonight, are you?
Certainly we are. It's probably only just around London. It's not raining now, as a matter of fact, if you're thinking of getting off right about now.
No, that's what I thought.
Yes, same here.
Which is another curious coincidence.
Oh, do shut up.
Aha! Hello? Hello, hello, hello? Yes. Mayfair X143. Hello? Hello? I'm sorry, I can't hear. It's thundering this end. What? Who? Who?
Oh!
Yes. Yes, rather. Do hold the line a minute and I'll go get him. Right you are. Do hold on. Sir Johnstone.
He's not here. Yes, yes, that's right. Yes, yes, that's quite correct. Quite right there. What? Oh, no, no. He'll be back soon, I expect. Probably held up in the... What? Oh, yes, dear. Well, I'll be back there soon now. I'll be coming pretty well straight away. What? Yes. Right you are. Right you are. Goodbye. Ronald hasn't come back.
Hasn't come back?
No.
Oh, that's the storm.
Yes. That's what it must be.
Didn't you say he'd been to the Colosseum?
That's right.
I am disliking the telephone tonight.
Was he expected back then, sir?
Yes. Apparently he arranged to get back to tea. My wife gets so alarmed if there's any hitch.
Oh, I'm sure he'll probably be back by the time you get home.
Yes. Yes. I expect he will. Well, we must be off. Where do we leave our hats and coats? Oh, downstairs.
Yes, I'll go and get them.
Well, we've got your parcel already.
Oh, that is so sweet of you. Thank you very much. That's a wonderful parcel, isn't it?
Well, it's not bad, is it?
I should say not. Yes, that's very convenient.
Here they are, Sir Johnstone. And it's not raining now. Of course, I do suspect that you would like a taxi, though, wouldn't you?
Yes. I think I'd like a taxi. I'd rather like to get back. I can't think where that boy's got to.
Here you are.
Thank you. I've never known him fail when he says he'll be back.
Oh, then he must be very filial, sir.
Yes, he is. Well, then it only remains to thank you for the most charming evening, to say nothing of the most charming company, the company being even more delightful than the books, and that's saying an enormous amount. Well, good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night, sir.
Good night, Mr. Cadell.
Good night, sir.
And I'll have to give you something in exchange for those books, you know.
Never, sir.
Oh, yes. You must have something back. You must have some swaps, as we used to say. You must have your swaps.
No.
Oh,
no,
yes.
Sir. No, sir. You're forgetting them, sir.
Thank you. That won't do, will it? Just like me. Just like me. I'm getting on, you know. I'm getting old. That's my trouble.
And I'll drop you.
What part, then, do you live, Mr. Raglan?
Me? Oh, I live up at Hampstead.
Oh, I see. It'd be quite easy to drop her, then.
I wish you'd drop your sarcastic remarks.
Pardon, pardon. I crave your pardon. I'm always suspecting love's young dream when it's non-existent.
Stay and have another spot.
Oh, no. Thanks awfully. I really think it's about
Yes, I thought so.
Well, if you two are still thinking about going up tonight, I certainly wouldn't let him drive.
What do you mean?
I will not, Leila. You may be sure of it. You ought to be ashamed of yourself, Grano.
You certainly ought.
What do you mean?
Well.
Good night, Granny.
Good night, Robert.
Well? All's well.
God, I thought he got onto it.
Who? Rupert?
Yes.
Yes, so did I. For a few moments, anyway. But that's what gave piquancy to the evening. He hadn't.
You're sure he hadn't?
Quite sure. I sometimes wish he rather had. God. Rupert. Queer lad. I wonder. If he had been with us, you wouldn't have gotten drunk, Grano.
I'm not drunk. I'm a little blurred, that's all. Hello? Who was that?
What?
I thought I heard something.
Be yourself, Grano.
I thought it was the bell. It was!
Well? What of it? I'll go down. He's left his cigarette case behind, apparently. Have you seen it?
No.
Well, it must be here somewhere. Hello. You came up.
Yes. I thought you might give me another spot.
You're welcome, Rupert.
I beg your pardon, humbly.
Why? You ass! Just a splash, Rupert.
Yes. generous one. Dear heaven, what unmentionable fatigue.
What?
Living. 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 I wonder if this is a way out. I shall try Omarism one day. The mighty Mahmud, the victorious lord, to whom all the misbelieving and black hold are fears and horrors that infest the soul, scatters and slays with this enchanted sword. Grano seems to agree with that.
Yes, but he's not going to get any more.
You're in a horrible state tonight, Granillo. You're positively silent drunk.
I'm all right.
I say, must we have this light?
What's wrong with the light?
Nothing is wrong with the light, Granillo. Merely that I am a creature of half-light. And seeing that you have a very pleasantly shaded little table lamp, can't we make use of it?
Yes, I quite agree. Of course, don't think you're going to settle down too heavily and make yourself too much at home, because we've got to be off before long.
Ah, that's better. Much better. I am sad tonight, you know. What's the time?
About 5:20 to 11.
5:20 to 11. I expect you're wanting to get rid of me, aren't you?
Not at all, Rupert.
I hope not. I'm full of melancholy, and I don't want to go home. You must bear with me. It's been such a strange evening.
Strange evening? Why?
Why strange?
I can't tell you. That's my trouble. I suppose it's the thunder, and one thing or another. Thunder always upsets me. And besides, I'm always melancholy at this hour, 5:20 to 11. It's a curious hour. Did you ever read Goldsmith's Night Piece?
No. I can't actually recall it.
No, you should. It's about the city at night. I shall do his night piece up to date one of these days, and I shall make it 5:20 to 11. Now. It's a wonderful hour. I am particularly susceptible to it.
Why so wonderful?
Because it is, I think, the hour when London asks why. When it wants to know what it's all about. When the tedium of activity and the folly of pleasure are equally transparent. It is the hour in which unemployed servant girls and spoiled beauties of the slums walk the streets for hire. It is the hour of winking advertisement signs, and taxis, and buses, and traffic blocks. It is the hour when jaded London theatre audiences are settling down into the darkness to the last acts of plays to which they know the denouement only too well. They know it will just be a question of God save the king, and they'll be bundled out into a chilly, possibly rainy night, whether to fight for taxis or rush for trains or somehow transport themselves home to a cold supper and the prospect of another day tomorrow exactly similar to which has passed. For others, further hours are waiting. The nightclubs and cabarets have not yet begun, but they will do so very soon. I could enlarge upon the idea indefinitely. 5:20 to 11. It's a horrible hour. A macabre hour. But it is not only the hour when pleasure has ended. It is the hour when pleasure itself has been found wanting. There. That is what this hour means to me, and it has, moreover, been thundery. 5:20 to 11.
Yes, 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 Rupert. But by the time you are done making your speech, it'll already be 11 o'clock. In brief, my dear Rupert, you see no earthly object in living?
I fear not. Do you?
I? Yes, of course I do. But then, I'm interested in things. Why don't you get interested in things? Why don't you take up exploring? Or cricket? Or making love? Or golf? Or finance? Or lecturing? Or something?
Or, as you have suggested this evening, murder.
Or, as you say, murder. Now then, Rupert, we don't want to turn you out.
Oh, surely you're not going to do that. Surely you're not going to spoil my mood.
Not at all. We're not going to spoil any of your moods. But we've got to get going before long, and we've got quite a bit of packing to do, and one thing and another.
Oh, you really mustn't spoil my mood. I shall write something tonight if I go on like this. You can't be so cruel. Can't I have another drink?
Well, all right. There's no hurry whatever. Only a poetic frame of mind will hardly be induced by the spectacle of Grano and me filling suitcases.
Oh, I certainly think it would. Can't I stay and watch you?
Well, we'll see. You know, I do believe you're a bit blotto tonight too, Rupert.
I wouldn't be surprised. I'll tell you what, I'll stay and see you off.
That's enough of that, Grano.
Mind your own business.
Come along, Grano, I said that's enough.
Mind your own business!
That's not my business. Stay and see us off, Rupert. All right. You finish that up and see how you feel about it. Doesn't look as though we'll get off with Grano in this state.
I'm perfectly sober. Why does he want to stay and see us off? That's what I want to know. Why does he want to stay and see us off?
My dear Grano, Rupert has no earthly reason in wanting to stay here. And I don't know what you're talking about. There's no doing anything with you. I'm getting sick of it. Come along, Rupert. Finish that up and leave him with me.
Oh, I've got to go then.
What do you mean, Rupert? You've got to go.
Oh, I thought for a moment that perhaps you wanted me to go as well.
Nothing of the sort. I was just getting fed up with all this silly chatter and wanted to be alone with Grano, that's all. I don't want you to go.
You don't?
No.
All right then, I'll stay. Can I have another drink?
I said so! I said so!
You're in a queer mood tonight, Rupert, too.
No, not a queer mood. An inspired mood, rather. One has inspirations, you know. Extraordinary inspirations. And I have one tonight.
Oh? And what's that?
I'll tell you that, perhaps. You haven't such thing as a pin, Granillo, have you?
A what?
A pin.
Yes.
Thank you. Ah, thank you. I shan't be long now.
It's no hurry. Past a quarter to, though. Oh, Lord. I don't feel like driving tonight after all.
No, there's something in the air tonight. Did you notice Sir Johnstone's exit?
No.
Rather subdued, I thought.
and pathetic. Well, I must be going. What's it doing?
It's better now.
And so to bed.
Well, Rupert, thanks for coming round and all that.
The pleasure is mine. Mine altogether. Believe me, it's been a very interesting evening.
Hello. What's your buttonhole?
He's got it. He's got it.
Hold your tongue, Grano.
Oh, yes. He's got it all right.
Hold it.
He's got it.
Hold your tongue.
He's got it.
Hold your tongue.
He's
hold your
it.
Filthy tongue. Hold your row. Hold your row. Rupert.
Yes?
Rupert? This has nothing to do with you. Grano and I have a certain trouble between us which concerns no one else. Would you kindly oblige us by going at once and leaving us to it?
Won't you tell me your trouble, Brandon? I might be able to help.
No, I will not tell you our troubles. Please go. It's nothing to do with you.
It may not have anything to do with me, Brandon, but it may have something to do with the public in general. And I'm its only representative in this room. Won't you tell me?
Are you going, or are you not?
No, I'm not going, you see. I'm rather awkwardly situated.
You are something more than that, my friend.
Oh? How's that?
You are very dangerously situated. Very dangerously situated indeed.
Brandon, I am lame, and I have no protection.
You have not.
Save that of my foresight.
Your foresight?
This is a compensation as well as an encumbrance. And besides, I have another little weapon, which is even greater value to me.
And what's that?
This, a whistle. A policeman gave it to me.
Oh, and when did he give you that?
He gave it to me 20 minutes ago, before I came back for my cigarette case. He's waiting at the corner. He's waiting for me to use it. Depends upon you whether I shall use it or not.
What do you want from me, Rupert?
I want two things. Two truths. The truth about this ticket here, and the truth about that chest there, or rather, its contents.
I can satisfy you on both. As for the ticket, I know nothing about it. And as for the chest, I simply do not know what you mean.
You have succeeded in satisfying me on neither.
Rupert, I've come to the conclusion that you are hopelessly drunk, and that you had better go home.
It is possible that I am drunk, but not hopelessly, and I am not going home.
What is all this about? What is all this maudlin suspiciousness?
This is not maudlin suspiciousness, Brandon. This is well-founded. From the moment I telephoned this house at 7:45 and heard over the wire your friend there crying for the dark, suspicion was there, and that suspicion has been growing ever since.
Growing ever since? Growing ever since? What do you mean? What could you possibly suspect?
I suspect murder, Brandon. The murder of Ronald Kentley.
Rupert, have you gone mad?
I dare say so. Perhaps you prove that I have.
You suspect What did you say?
Murder, Brandon.
Oh, dear God. Oh, my poor, poor Rupert. You don't know how you relieved me. I'd suspect you got on to the real truth, which had been devilish awkward, but... Murder? Oh, dear, that's good. You hear that, Grano? He suspects us of murder. Murder! Isn't that too rich?
Is it possible that you're trying to bluff me?
Bluff you? You drunken, sodden maniac! Bluff you! Get on out of here! Blow your whistle! Bring your policemen in! Get on out! Do what you like!
But since you say I can do what I like, may I see the inside of that chest?
See the inside of that chest? See the inside of that chest? You can see the inside of 50,000 chests! Get on out!
I did not ask to see the inside of 50,000 chests, Brandon, but to see the inside of that specific chest. And I cannot do that if I have to get on out.
You're mad and drunk!
Possibly. Nevertheless, may I see inside that chest?
Yes!
Very well, I will.
Well, go on. What are you waiting for?
You're very clever in any case, Brandon.
I wish I could say the same for you, you fantastic ass.
Will you get Father Swain, please? Will you go down to that chair? It's locked. Padlocked.
What of it?
Where's the key?
I don't know. Why should I know? It's upstairs, I think.
Upstairs?
Yes. Shall I go get it?
No. Don't do that. I can force it. Must I do this? Must I do this?
Here's your key! Here's your key! Now look! Get what's coming to you!
Thank you.
You'll be sorry if you look in there, Cadell. You'll be sorry.
I'll take the risk. We go back down to that chair. Swine. You dirty swine!
Now then, Rupert, sit down. I want to talk to you.
Poor Ronald Kennedy. What did he do to you?
Sit down, Rupert. For God's sake, sit down. I want to talk to you.
Sit down, Brandon.
Sit down. For God's sake, sit down. I can explain.
Explain?
Oh, sit down. For God's sake, sit down. I'm at your mercy here, I tell you. I'm at your mercy. Have mercy on me. I can explain.
Sit down and judge me! Sit down and judge me!
Well?
Rupert, you're an enlightened man, aren't you?
I profess to be, yes.
And it's in your power to have me hanged.
So it seems.
And Granillo too.
And Granillo too.
Rupert.
Yes?
Do you remember our talk tonight? About the Old Bailey and justice.
Yes, well.
And the difference between the two. You made the point.
Yes.
Yes. Well, remember that. You wouldn't be giving us up to justice. And now I want to ask you something else. You're not a man of morals, are you?
No, I'm not.
And you do not rate life as a precious thing, do you?
No.
Listen, Rupert, listen. I've done this thing. I and Grano. We have done it together. We have done it for adventure. For adventure and danger. For danger. You read Nietzsche, don't you, Rupert?
Yes.
And you know that he tells us to live dangerously.
Yes.
And you know he's no more respect for individual life than you, and tells us to live dangerously. We thought we would do so. That's all. We have done so. We have only done the thing. Others have talked, but we have done. Do you understand, Rupert?
Go on.
Listen, Rupert, listen. You're understanding, I think. You're the one man to understand. But apart from all that, quite apart, even if you can't see how we... Look at it! You'll see that you can't give us up. Two lives can't recall one. It'd just be triple murder. You'd never allow that to happen. But apart from that too, our lives are in your hands. You can't kill us, Rupert. You can't kill. If you have us up now, it'd be killing us as much as if you were to run us through with that sword in your hand. You're not a murderer, Rupert.
What are you?
We aren't. We aren't, I tell you. Don't tell me you're a slave of your period. In the days of Borgias, you'd have thought nothing of this. For God's sakes, tell me you're an emancipated man, Rupert. You can't give us up. You know you can't. You can't. You can't. You can't. Can you?
Yes, I know there's every truth in what you've said. This is a very queer, dark, and incomprehensible universe, and I understand it little. I myself have always tried to apply pure logic to it, and the application of logic can lead us into strange passes. It has done so in this case. You have brought up my own words in my face. And a man should stand by his own words. I shall never trust in logic again. You said that I hold life cheap. You're right. I do. Your own included.
What do you mean?
What do I mean? What do I mean? I mean that you have taken and killed by strangulation, a very harmless and helpless fellow creature of 20 years. I mean in that chest there, now lie the staring and futile remains of something that 4 hours ago lived and laughed and ran and found it good. Laughed as you could never laugh, and ran as you could never run. I mean that for your cruel and scheming pleasure. You've committed a sin and blasphemy against the very life. You now find yourself so precious. And you have done more than this. You have not only killed him. You've rotted the lives to all those he was dear. Done worse than death to his father. An equally harmless old man who fought his way quietly through to a peaceful end, and whom after this his whole universe will be blackened and distorted beyond the limits of thought. That is what you have done! And in bringing him around here tonight, you played a lewd and infamous jest upon him, and a bad jest at that. And if you think, as your sort of philosopher generally does, that all of life is nothing but a bad jest, then you'll have the pleasure of seeing it played upon yourselves.
What are you saying? What are you going to do?
It's not what I am going to do, Brandon. It's what society is going to do. And what will happen to you at the hands of society, I am not in a position to tell you. That's its own business. I can give you a pretty shrewd guess, I think. You're going to hide, you swine!